मैम कैन वी स्टार्ट मैम?
यस सर, वी कैन स्टार्ट द सेशन. ओके, थैंक यू. आई हिबा फरीन, एन एकेडमिक कंसल्टेंट इन इंग्लिश ऑफ ओडिशा स्टेट ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी. वी आर हैविंग एन ऑनलाइन सेशन फॉर द ग्रेजुएशन फॉर द ग्रेजुएट्स एंड द टुडेज टॉपिक इज ब्रिटिश प्रोज ऑफ 18th सेंचुरी एंड द यूनिट दैट वी आर कवरिंग इज जोसेफ एडिसन्स एसे नेम्ड गुड नेचर. सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन वी नीड टू No, who this writer is and about his social background. So before beginning, let us know who this Joseph Edison was. So we are talking about the age, Augustan age, and how in that particular age, the periodicals that had a good name and position at that time, and it occupied a quite reputed position in that era. So Joseph Edison was an English essayist. He was a poet, playwright, and a politician. And he being an eldest son of the Reverend Lancelot Edison, his name is usually remembered along with his friend Richard Steele. As we know that Richard and Steele and Edison are good collaboration of the two that produced the different essays and periodicals at that time, and with whom the Spectator magazine was founded. So Edison was born in Milston, Wiltshire, but soon after his birth, his father Lancelot Edison was appointed as a dean of Lichfield, and Edison family moved into Cathedral close by. So he was educated at Charterhouse School, where he first met Richard Steele, and at the Queen's College, Oxford. He had an excellence in classics, and he was being noted for his Latin verse, and he became a fellow of Magdalen College. In 1693, he even addressed a poem to John Dryden, and his first major work, a book on the lives of the English poet, that was published in 1694. And even his translation of Virgil's Georgius was published in the same year. Dryden, Lord Somers, Charles Montague, first Earl of Halifax, they all took interest in Edison's work. And when Edison returned to England at the end of the 1703, for more than a year, he remained unemployed. But the Battle of Blenheim that took place in 1704, it gave him a fresh opportunity to distinguish himself. Even the government, specifically Lord Treasurer Godolphin, he was commissioned to write a commemorative poem about the battle, and even he produced the campaign, and which was received with great satisfaction, and for which he was appointed as a commissioner of appeal in Halifax government. And his next literary venture was an account of his travels in Italy, then remarks on several parts of Italy in year 1701, 1702, 1703, and that was published in 1705 by Jacob Johnson. In 1705, with the Whigs in power, Edison was made Under Secretary of the State, and he accompanied Lord Halifax on a diplomatic mission to Hanover, Germany. So, regarding the biography of Edison, it states that in a field of his foreign responsibilities, Edison's views were those of a good Whig, and he had always believed that England's power depended upon her wealth, her wealth upon her commerce, and her commerce upon the freedom of the seas and the checking of power of France and Spain. In 1708 and 1709, Edison was a member of parliament for the borough of Lopwith Hill, and he was soon appointed as secretary to the new lieutenant of Ireland, Lord Wharton, under the direction of Wharton, and he was an MP, member of parliament in the Irish House of Commons for Cavan Borough from 1709 until 1713. And in 1710, he represented Malmesbury in his home county in Wiltshire, holding the seat until his death in 1719. Then he met Jonathan Swift in Ireland and remained there for a year. Later, he helped form the Kit Kat Club and renewed his friendship with Richard Steele. In 1709, Steele began to publish The Tatler, and Edison became a regular contributor to it. In 1711, they started the Spectator, and the first issue that appeared on 1st March 1711. This paper, which was originally a daily, was published until 20th of December 1714, interrupted for a year by the publication of the Guardian in 1713. And his last publication was Freeholder, a political paper in 1715 to 1716. And in any event, wrote the libretto for Thomas Clayton's opera Rosamund, which had a disastrous premiere in London in 1707. In 1713, Addison's tragedy Cato was produced and was received with great acclamation by both Whigs and Tories party. And he followed his effort with a comedic play, The Drummer, in 1716. In 1712, Edison wrote his most famous work, Cato, that was a tragedy that was based on the last days of Marcus Porcius Cato Uticensis, which dealt with conflicts such as individual liberty versus government tyranny, republicanism versus monarchism, logic versus emotions, and Cato's personal struggle to retain his beliefs in face of death. It has a prologue that was written by Alexander Pope and epilogue by Samuel Garth. So about the play was a great success throughout British Empire, and it continued to grow in popularity, especially in America, for several generations. It is even cited by many historians as a literary inspiration for American Revolution, and being known to many as the founding father. So General George Washington, he sponsored a performance of Cato for the Continental Army during the difficult winter of 1777-78 at Valley Forge. So according to John Miller, no single work of literature may have been more important than Cato for the leaders of American Revolution. This was the quotation or the lines made by John J. Miller. So Addison wrote the popular church hymn, The Spacious Firmament on High, publishing it in Spectator in 1712. It is sung either to tune known as London by Steel Schiller, that was written in 1720, or to Creation by Franz Haydn in 1798. That was a hymn. And the later part of Edison's life was not without its trouble. In 1716, when he married Charlotte Duager, Countess of Warwick, after working for a time as a tutor for her son, his political career continued, and he served as a Secretary of State for the Southern Department for 1717 to 1718. And his political newspaper, The Freeholder, that was much criticized. And Alexander Pope, in an epistle to Dr. Arbuthnot, made him an object of derision, naming him as Atticus and comparing him to an adder that is willing to wound, and even yet afraid to strike. And his wife was arrogant and imperious. His stepson, Edward Rich, was an unfriendly rake. Edison's shyness in public limited his effectiveness as a member of parliament, and he eventually fell out with Steele over the Peerage Bill of 1719. In 1718, Addison was forced to resign as a secretary of the state because of his poor health, but he remained as member of parliament until his death at Holland House, London, on 17 June 1719 at the age of 48. So Addison was buried in Westminster Abbey after his death. An apocryphal story that circulated that Edison, on his deathbed, had sent for his wastrel stepson to witness how a Christian man meets death. So it is an essay that Edison, being an essayist, is remembered today as an essayist. And Edison began writing essays quite casually. In April 1709, his childhood friend Richard Steele, he started the Tatler. And Addison contributed 42 essays to the Tatler, while Steele wrote 188. Regarding Addison's health, Steele remarks that, when I had once called him in, I could not subsist without dependence on him. So this was a kind of contribution that they had and formed a collaborative effort. So in January 2nd, 1711, Tatler was discontinued. And on 1st March 1711, the Spectator was published, and it continued until 6th December 1712. So the Spectator was issued daily and achieved great popularity, and it exercised an influence over the reading public of the time. Edison soon became the leading partner in the Spectator, and he contributed about 274 essays out of total 555. and Steele wrote 236. So Edison also assisted Steele with the guardian, which began in 1713. So the breezy conversational style of the essays later prompted Bishop Richard Hurt to reprove Edison for what he called as Edisonian termination or preposition stranding or grammatical construction that ends a sentence with a preposition. And he even wrote an essay entitled Dialogues on Medals, which was translated to French through the French by 18th century priest and journalist Simon Jerome Bollet de Vaucelles. So he also left an incomplete work of the Christian religion. So these were the different essays that he wrote, and this was a contribution that he made to the society at large by his different works. So now we are heading towards the essay named the named Good Nature that was written by Joseph Edison. So so we must be having our text in hand so that it would be quite easier for us to read and understand. Then also we are starting with the quotation that was made by Terence, and it was a Roman language that's written in. So we are trying to translate it, and we will be reading it in this manner that according the way that Terence has says that his manner of life was this, that to bear with everybody's humor and to comply with inclinations and pursuits of those he conversed with, never to contradict, never to assume oneself superior to other, and this is the ready way to gain applause without exciting envy. So the very quotation that was made by Terence is to be to bear with everybody's humor and to comply with everybody's inclination. And then only when we have that that nature of bearing others' behavior, so that we won't be contradicting them and we won't be trying to show oneself superior over the other. And in this way, we can gain a lot of applause without enticing or exciting envy in others. So this was a quotation that was made by Terence. So now, beginning with the essay and the way the Edison tries to portray good nature and his viewpoint is can be found out in this essay. So when this essay was written, or the very beginning of the essay, it says that mankind or the man in general, there are lots of pain and suffering, and by the very condition of the humanity is that it's normal or it's natural for the human life to have pains and sorrows. And yet, as if nature, it's because of the nature that has sown this evil enough in our life, and that adds on grief to grief, and it aggravates the very commonality of life. The very calamity, that cruel treatment that we give to one another, is the very outcome of the nature that we people have. So every man's natural weight of affliction is much more due to this envy, malice, treachery, or injustice that we do to oneself and to the neighbor. So at the same time, he says that the storm that beats on the whole species, and in the way we are, when we try to inflict pain on others, it's we who gets hurt. So half of the misery of the human life will be extinguished if we people try to have that compassion, that benevolence and humanity in our mutual offices. So there is none. He even says that one must encourage in oneself that sort of goodness in one nature, that disposition of mind, which is in our language. So language must be in such a manner that it should be polite and it should be of a heart-touching one. And good nature is the more agreeable when it comes to conversation than to the portrayal of wit that we normally consider. So it's normally a way how we speak, how we converse with people, and that gives a quite a great certain air to the countenance, which is quite amiable rather than beauty. So, and the very virtue that we talk about, or the fairest light, or the measure of the even the negativity gets diminished, and even the follies or the impertinence that we say, it's quite neglected, or it's quite eclipsed by the very beauty of the virtue of the good nature of the communication. So in a society where conversation is all that is, that keeps the world running, what we say, the very appearance. So the human beings have even tried to create or invented an artificial humanity. So it may be through imitation or mimicry of good nature. It's not from the from the core of the heart. Rather, it's acting as a superficial one. And we are carrying it forward with the hypocrisy, like hypocrisy in religion or the bare form of holiness that we say. And it's quite gaining popularity. But the very depth of the good nature is born with us. It cannot be implanted. Okay. So it's born with us. It's like a health, prosperity, or the crime treatment that we give to the world. These are the things that are act as a cherishers, and it's kind of a healer. It can't be forced. It can't be implanted forcibly. So, and but the only thing that can be done is through the that education that can improve, but it cannot produce in itself. That's the way that Edison is trying to portray in his essay. So even he has cited the example of Xenophon. So Xenophon, who was in his life, he used to live a life of an imaginary prince. And he was the one who used to celebrate the philanthropy or the good nature of his hero. So when he was in his deathbed, he realized that when he will die, his soul will be meeting God. And he made a pledge, or he tried to incorporate this feeling in his son, that let him be buried in earth, not to be enshrined in gold or silver. And that and this was the very thought or the incorporation that he made, that he would be trying to be incorporated with the great mother of all things, and it would be quite beneficial to the whole mankind. So this thought of the very thought of being good or being service to the mankind is itself a change that can be noticed in through the example of Xenophon. Then there's a different instances that can be shown, that how the overflowing of humanity or the exuberant love that a person have towards the mankind, and even the soul that is filled with great ideas or benevolence to mankind, can be seen. So there is a passage of Sallust, and how there's a comparison made between the Caesar and Cato, how the Caesar's very good nature is portrayed, and it is showed towards his friend or his enemies, even towards his servants or his dependents, and the guilty or his distress. So whoever may the person be, we shouldn't change our nature, because a person is known by the nature that he possesses. But when we contrast Caesar with Cato, Cato is quite awful rather than amiable. And in the case that we compare it with the mankind and the God, that even it says that justice is quite agreeable to the nature of God and mercy to that of man. So this is the thing that is tried to be compared and contrasted. And we human beings must have this quality of forgiving people. And by forgiving them, it's we are doing a favor to oneself, because by taking the negativity from the others, it's the way of we are trying to hamper or damage our relationship with oneself. So it's even said that the rigid or the severe temper is quite a worthless man, because he won't be able to forgive the others. And the best action must be ingrained with the allowance of being moderate, being forgiving, and these are the qualities that a person must have. And the very nature of this rigidness or severity is quite worthless, because the person won't be forgiving the other, and himself might be damaging his own relation with oneself. So the part of the good nature that we are dealing with is pardoning, overlooking of faults, and these all can be practiced in a commerce or the occurrence of life. But these manner of forgiving cannot be applied in the field of administration or justice, because in that case, if you are showing mercy to one, then normally or definitely it would be cruelty to the other. So this is the very two-sided of the good nature can be portrayed over here. And even there is a good maxim that has been said, that good natured mad are not always men of the most wit. So it's just an opinion that people have, but there's no foundation in the nature, because the greatest wits that the person possesses, it's because of the humanity nature, humanness that they have, and that's the people that like for. So there are two reasons that has been portrayed here, that ill nature among the ordinary observer passes for wit, because they gratify or get a sense of pleasing nature when the person is talking about someone or being spiteful of some other's behavior, and they will be laughing at them, or they will be looking at as a shrewd satirist. So this may be the one reason why there is a great sort of pleasant companions appears to be more dull, and this is the reason why the good people's companion seems dull, and they try, and when they try to endeavor to be merry in print, so the very private clubs or the assemblies that distinguishes what is wit and what is ill nature that can be seen through this maxim that good natured men are not always men of most wit. There is a different, there's other reason that has been shown that good natured man may sometimes bring his wit into questions. Like when a good person is quite moved by the other person's misfortunes or infirmities, and he would be displaying his compassion, then he would be ridiculed by the so-called reputation of wit. So ill-natured man, though, but of equal parts, he might be having that feeling of expatriate, and he exposes his feelings in the human nature. So while the other person would be laughing at, he would be casting a veil over it, while the good one would be trying to conceal it by through his reflections or through his utterances. So these are the two different sides of the same of the quality of the nature that a person possesses. One is trying to be that compassion is trying to be portrayed in a negative manner by the laugh or the wit of the other person. And in normal life too, the very nature of the wit that is growing and how in different way they grow rich or the trade, they normally stand upright in the society or the place. So now we are heading towards the second part of good nature, and here we are having the quotation from the Tate and even Juvenal. So who can all sense of others ill escape is but a brute at best in human shape. So the very bruteness of human nature has got a quite good shape in the form of a human. So in the last paper, he told us about how the good nature is, and how the very constitution of good nature must be. And here he will be speaking on the very moral virtue of how a man's man's very nature in himself, and how it's to be agreeable to others. And even he implies not just the merit, but that is possessed by the very core of the human nature. So he says that the very account of the good nature must be as regular as a heartbeat or as good as a digestion, but it's not that the very good nature is portrayed of. So he says that a man is no more to be praised upon this account than because he has a regular pulse or a good digestion. So this good nature in the constitution, what Mr. Dryden has said, the milkiness of blood is an admirable groundwork for the other. So in order to understand this or to try out what the good nature is, it arises from the body or the mind. And it is found in animals or the rational part of our nature, or in a word that is entitled to any reward or secret satisfaction that one gets, contentment of mind, any essential or the very satisfaction that a person attains and helps to run the world. These are the different ways that the person can identify what a good nature is and what kind of good nature that the person derives from. So the very first act that he tries to say is the steadiness and uniformity in sickness and in health. So the very posture of the good nature is should be stable one. It shouldn't be varying or changing if a person is sick or in health. And whether one is in prosperity or adversity, there mustn't be a change in his nature. A person's nature must be fixed one. If it is good, then he must maintain that irrespective of the situation, else it would be termed as irradiation of the mind. Like it would be when a person comes to meet a new good person, he would be like energetic and he would be talking in a good manner. But when he meets a rude or impolite person, then he would be turning in that manner. So that's not the way a good nature must be. So Sir Francis Bacon, he mentions about a cunning solicitor who won't be asking for a favor when a great man before a dinner or when he is on the dining table, but when everything would be normal or who would be in good nature or his mind would be free from any sorts of care, then at that time who would be pricking with different sorts of questions or his way of asking. So the very good nature shouldn't be transient or temporary. Rather, it's a philanthropy. It's a love towards mankind, and that deserves to be termed as a title of moral virtue. So the next way of a man's bringing his good nature to the test is to consider the very rule of reason and duty, what he has towards the mankind or towards the society. So its general benevolence to mankind, or its distinction between its object, like if he exerts his promiscuity towards deserving and the undeserving, like if he relieves alike the idle and the indigent, if he gives itself up to the first petitioner and lights upon any other rather by accident than by choice. So it shows a very amiable instinct that a person must have, then only it can be termed as a moral virtue. And the very change of nature in different situation won't be termed or categorized as a moral virtue. And the third trial that can be taken of the good nature is by examining oneself or ourselves. How much we are willing to risk any part of our fortune or reputation or even of health or ease for the benefit of the mankind. So the self-sacrifice or the self-willingly when we try to give up for the goodness of the mankind, that too comes under the category of good nature. And this way we can test that, do we possess this good nature quality or not. So, and even in the name of charity and how we try to relieve the indigent or how we try to help the society at large. So this was the third trial that is spoken in the essay. So now he's proposing as a rule to everyone who is to be provided with any competency of fortune more than the sufficient for necessaries of life. So there are certain proportion of income that could be given to the poor or one who is in need. And the way we try to give it to the poor, it's just an offering that God, that Lord has provided us with. And we are just giving just a portion to the one who is needy, and it's because of the divine blessing that we people are having things and just giving the things that it's that is his own. It's a charity, and that too one must do it with prudence and caution without hurting one's family or friends' relations. So one of the best example that has been cited is this story of Eugenius, who was a person of universal good nature, and he was too generous, and but he was prudent in his economical affair, and he did his charity in such a good management way, we can say that he used to do charity voluntarily, and it's been cited that his annual or his world class income can be cited as a £200 a year, but he never valued it more than or above 9 scores, and he has a right to the 10th part only. And this way he used to do the charity, like when he has to go travel somewhere, so he would be walking afoot, and by saving a shilling, and the person whom he met on the first place, he would be giving that amount to that person. And it's and then the second example is shown that even when he had even made up a mind of going to play or an opera house, then he would divert the money and divert the purpose as well by just attending a coffee house, spending an evening with a friend, and that too with a great satisfaction. So this was a two way that he tried to totally change his way just to make a contribution, and in that too he attained great satisfaction and he attained that happiness. So the kind of satisfaction that he attained from the coffee house or with the companion of a friend, it can't be achieved or it can't be received from the exquisite entertainments of the theater even. So his generosity was not quite improvising himself, rather he enjoyed a lot by doing these sorts of charity. So and there are certain different examples of the few men who are quite cramped up in their private affairs so much that they never ever think of doing the charity, and they even don't do any sort of disadvantage to themselves or prejudice to their family even. So it's but sometimes something like a sacrificing or coming out of the convenience zone and doing the best for the society at large. So this was the way of being convenient, prudent in one's management of the resources and helping the needy. Now there's a different reference is made to the Sir Thomas Brown's his Religio Medici. In that he says that he that gives to the poor, he lent it to the Lord. So it's quite a rhetoric and it's quite commanding tone. Just we need to be honest what we are doing. and it's and the very line is quite loaded with meaning, and it's quite heavy to take, that how can we lend to the Lord? So just we need to be simple and be honest by the very epitome. So there's a different scriptures, there's a New Testament, and the book of the Job all says about how the very contribution that can be made, like the where our Savior tells us in the most pathetic manner that he shall hereafter regard the clothing of the naked, feeding of the hungry, and the visiting of the imprisoned as offices done to himself. Reward them accordingly. So this was the way the Savior or Jesus Christ has told, that one need to clothe the naked, one need to feed the hungry, and one need to visit the imprisoned. And these are the offices, these are the works that need to be done, and the reward, and reward them accordingly. So these were the lines or the preaches that is made by the Holy Scriptures. So, and then the epitaph of a charitable man is, I would like to quote that, what I spend, I lost. What I possessed is left to others. What I gave away remains with me. So this is the beauty of charity that a person does. So, and there are innumerable sacred words of the from the Holy Scriptures, and it can be taken into account, taking the behavior in the days of his prosperity. How the person behaves in this day of prosperity is often considered as a human composition in a finer picture of a charitable and good-natured man than is to be met with in any other author. So the very goodness or the very prosperous life when we lead, it's that time that we need to think of the society and the manner when we do the contribution in our prosperity determines our future. So there's again a quotation that is there, that that I were as in months past, as in the days when God preserved me, when his candles shined upon my head, and when by his light I walked through darkness, when the Almighty was yet with me, when my children were about me, when I washed my steps with butter and the rock poured over rivers or oil. So these were the prosperous time that he was having, and God was, and every time God is there, and he used to act as a beacon of light who used to guide him, and he do definitely guide him even in his happiness and even in his darkest of the times. So the he even says that when the ear heard me and then blessed me. So when he makes a prayer, when he asks the Lord, so the ears heard it and blessed it with, when the eyes saw it and gave witness to it, because I delivered the poor that cried and fatherless and him that had none to help him. So he says that a person, when he hears someone crying or when someone is needy, one need to help them. And whenever, in whatever way one can do the help to the needy, it's a blessing. It's a divine gift, because by helping others, we are helping oneself only, because the kind of goodness that we add to our list, the good deeds that we do, it's a quite an apparel that we will be wearing in the day of judgment. So the blessings of him that was ready to perish came upon me, and I caused the widow's heart to sing for joy. And I was eyes to the blind, and feet was I to the lame. I was father to the poor, and the cause which I knew not, I searched out. So did I not weep for him that was in trouble? Was not my soul grieved for the poor? Let me be weighed in even balance, that God may know my integrity. If I did despise the cause of my manservant or of my maidservant when they contended with me, when then shall I do when God riseth up and when he visiteth? What shall I answer him? Did not he that made me in the womb make me? And did not one fashion us in the womb? So he says that if he had withheld the position, withheld the poor from the desire, or caused the eyes of the widow to fail, or have eaten up the morsel just alone and without thinking of the fatherless person who hasn't anything to eat, and if he had seen anyone perishing from the want of clothing, or any poor without any covering, and even his loins have not blessed me, and if he were not warmed with the fleece of my sheep, so if he had lifted my hands against the fatherless when I saw my help in the gate, then the situation, then the outcome must be, let my arm fall from my soldier shoulder blade and mine arm be broken from the bone. So this must be the outcome if a person doesn't, he himself is saying that if I never ever did help to the needy, then let the misfortune befall me, let my arm fall from my soldier blade and mine arm be broken from the bone. If I had rejoiced at the destruction of him that hated me, or lift up myself when evil found him, so neither have I suffered my mouth to sin by wishing a curse to his soul. So the stranger didn't lodge in the street, but I opened my door to the traveler. And if my land cry against me, or that furrows likewise thereof complain, if I have eaten the fruits thereof without money, or have caused the owners thereof to lose their life, let thistles grow instead of wheat, and cockle instead of barley. So the very firmness in his speech can be portrayed that if ever he lacked in his duty, or if ever he missed an opportunity of helping, or if a person has any ill feeling towards him regarding the support that he could have, the very consciousness or the intuition speaks that he won't be doing any sort of goodness to the other, then let the misfortune or the curse befall him. So this was the whole essay that Edison has spoken of about the good nature, the beginning with the very inculcation of the qualities that are required and how it can be portrayed in a person's nature. It shouldn't be temporary or transient, as said earlier. And the very nature of pardoning and the very nature of welcoming the people, though whatever the nature may be, the very milkiness of blood that portrays the goodness in the quality that has been said by Dryden himself. And the reason, and the taking into account the good nature with the reason and duty, and how do we think, how we act, and what are our responsibilities towards the mankind, and how much are we willing to sacrifice our comfort zone for the welfare of the society, then how much are we willing to give a portion of our fortune to the needy in the name of charity, and how are we planning to the very management, the very prudence that we apply in the work of charity, that too takes into account, and the very satisfaction that we get from this, from these pious act of charity, because we are not just helping others in the need, rather it's the blessing of the God who has provided us with ample, and out of that only we are just making a few contribution to the people who are in need. So this was a quite the language was quite lucid, the language was quite simple, and it was quite easy to understand, and hopefully you too have got the essence out of this essay. So thank you. This was all for today's session. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Heba ma'am, for this wonderful session. And I hope this session is recorded. And so I hope this session will be a lot helpful for the students who listen to it in the later times. And thank you so much. It was a very elaborate and comprehensive discussion. And we look forward for many such discussions. Thank you so much. I think we can call it a day now.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks to all the makers team and the
thank you, all of you. And dear learner, please fill the feedback form sent by Amit sir, Amit Tripathi sir. The link is given in your chat box. I repeat, please fill the feedback form. The link is given in the chat box by Mr. Amit Tripathi. Thank you. Thank you so much.